All right, so maybe we can get started. Hi, everybody. Welcome to the first installment of the AI for Social Impact seminar series. We are very honored to have with us Professor Milind Tambe. And I'm going to do a bio first. Professor Tambe is the Gordon MacKay Professor of Computer Science, and he's also the founding director of Center for Research in Computation and Society at Harvard. He also started the Center for Artificial Intelligence Society at University of Southern California. He is also the director of AI for Social Good at Google Research India. Professor Tambe has many, many awards. If I were to list all the things that he's accomplished over his long illustrious career, we would need a pre-seminar before the actual seminar. So I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to list out a couple of major awards that he's won. He's the recipient, most recently, he's the recipient of the IJCAI John McCarthy Award, the ACM SIGAI Autonomous Agents Research Award from AMOS, the AAAI Robert S. Engelmore Memorial Lecture Award, and so on and so forth. And he's also a fellow of AAAI and ACM. Professor Tambe, welcome. We are very, very honored to have you here amongst us, and we're really excited to hear you speak to all our attendees. With that, I'll turn over the controls to Professor Tambe. People, everybody on the call, I would appreciate it if you can turn all of your microphones to mute. If you have questions, please hold them to the end of the talk. We are going to have it's going to be a 50-minute talk, and then there are going to be 10 questions. Sorry, 10 minutes for Q&A, and then any questions that you can have, you can at during that time, if you have questions, you can send a chat message, or you can unmute yourself directly and ask a question. So with that, Professor Tambe, please feel free to continue this talk. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Amulya. And thank you, everybody, for coming. It's really a great honor to be the first speaker in this very exciting series. I see the other speakers who are coming in as well. Awesome. And congratulations, Amulya, for the recent endowed chair. So thank you for inviting me. All right, so very exciting. I'll be talking about AI for public health and conservation. So the past several years, me and my team have been focused on how to use AI for social impact, particularly in areas such as public health, conservation, and public safety and security. In all of these areas, viewing these problems as multi-agent systems, this key research challenge we have focused on, how to optimize our limited intervention resources when interacting with other agents in these domains. With respect to public health, the challenge is that we have a large population to serve, but limited number of public health or social work resources. Key example here, a concrete example, is work we've done with youth experiencing homelessness in Los Angeles. Harnessing the social networks of these youth, we're able to show that our influence maximization algorithms are far more effective in spreading HIV information and reducing HIV risk behaviors compared to traditional approaches. The technical areas I'll focus on here are social networks and bandit algorithms. With respect to conservation, we have large conservation areas to protect limited number of ranger resources. Concrete example is work we have done in Uganda, in Cambodia, and other countries, where harnessing past poaching data, we are able to predict where poachers set traps or snares, and for the past several years, have been able to remove a large number of these snares. The technical area I'll focus on here is green security games that combines machine learning and game theory. With respect to public safety and security, we have a large number of targets to protect limited security resources. We have provided a new model called Stackelberg Security Games and new algorithms based on this model that have been in use by security agencies such as the US Federal Air Marshals Service to assign air marshals to flights by the US Coast Guard and others. Today, I'll focus on public health and conservation, skipping the area of public safety. These areas of public health and conservation have also been the focus of our work at Google Research India with several nonprofits. I will not have time to go through all of these projects in Google Research India. I'll focus particularly on the one with Arman, which is one of the nonprofits. In all of these different projects, you will see three themes that cut across. First, the use of multi-agent systems reasoning, such as use of social networks and game theory. Second, this data to deployment pipeline. We start with immersion in the domain, working with nonprofits to understand the kind of problems they're facing, the kind of data that are available. Following that, a predictive model makes predictions based on the data, which of the cases are high risk, which are low risk. Of course, we can't intervene on all of the high risk cases due to the limited resources, and that's where our prescriptive algorithm comes in to recommend which cases to actually intervene on. And following that, field testing and deployment is important to understand what kind of modifications we are needed for our models and algorithms. But of course, field testing and deployment is important because social impact is a key objective of our work. It's class citizen. So if we want to do AI for social impact and we don't have field testing and deployment to show social impact, then it's not really AI for social impact. Secondly, you'll see that lack of data is norm. We're supposed to be swimming in big data, but in many of the domains we work with marginalized communities, really, there is not much data. And so we have to deal with this lack of data. And thirdly, all of the work is in collaboration with nonprofits around the world, whether it's Safe Place for Youth, a homeless shelter in Los Angeles, or Arman, a nonprofit in India. We are working to ensure to empower these local area nonprofits to allow them to use their resources more effectively. Our goal is to empower nonprofits to use AI tools in general and avoid being gatekeepers to AI technology for social impact. So with this introduction, let me launch into the particular topics I'll focus on, starting with public health. And I'll cover papers from 2017 to now, the last 3 years in AMAS, AAAI, HCI, NEURIPS, and other conferences. I'll highlight the role of the PhD students and postdocs who led the work by putting their pictures in the top right-hand corner so you know who led that work. So let's start with information dissemination and behavior change. This is work where I'll use this example of preventing HIV amongst homeless youth in Los Angeles. Unfortunately, there's 6,000 homeless youth who sleep on the streets in Los Angeles every night. The rates of HIV amongst this population is 10 times the rate of the normal housed population. So shelters will use techniques, because they cannot communicate with all 6,000 youth themselves, of essentially influence maximization. They recruit peer leaders. These peer leaders are informed about HIV risk behaviors. The idea is that they'll talk to their friends and their friends will talk to their friends, and information will spread in the network to reduce HIV risk behaviors. Remember that these are real face-to-face interactions. This is not happening over Facebook. So this is the, you know, old-fashioned social network. Now, I should acknowledge here that I was fortunate enough to have Amulya Yadav as my PhD student when this work started. And he was responsible for really forging a collaboration between computer science and social work to get this project kicked off. So what is the problem here? We have a social network graph G, and we have to choose K peer leader nodes. We are going to assume information is going to spread in the network through an independent cascade model, which means I talk to some youth A, and some adjacent youth B will be informed by A with some probability. Information will spread in this fashion by cascading from A to B to C to D and so forth. Our objective is to maximize expected number of influence nodes. Now, when we try to apply this influence maximization from traditional computer science to our domain, we see three major challenges. First, there's uncertainty in propagation probability over edges. Second, we have multi-step dynamic policies to handle because peer leaders that we recruit may not show up to the particular information session. And thirdly, the social network itself is not available, and we have a limited query budget to uncover the network. I'm going to address these challenges one after another. I'll start with an assumption that we know the social network and then finally come to unknown social network case. So immersion in this domain taught us that whereas traditional influence maximization assumes that if you talk to some homeless youth C, that an adjacent youth D will be informed with a known probability of 0.4, this probability is difficult to get precisely right in this domain. So we can model it as sampling from some unknown distribution, from some known distribution. Unfortunately, the mean of this distribution might also be not known to us. So we can model this uncertainty by saying that this mean lies within a certain interval. So we are faced with this problem of robust influence maximization. We can model this as a problem of playing a game against nature. So our algorithm is trying to choose peer leaders to spread information about HIV prevention. And nature is trying to choose parameter settings to cause our algorithm to perform as worse as possible. So it is trying to set the mu and sigma for the distribution that I mentioned to be such that our algorithm will perform as worse as possible. So we're trying to play this max-min game. We are trying to maximize the spread of influence, and nature is trying to minimize where we express our rewards as a ratio between the outcome of our particular policy to choose peer leaders versus the optimal that would be possible had we known that particular mu and sigma in advance. Now, this is a mixed strategy, and then we sample from that the actual pure strategy. These are details that are not important to understand the overall story, so I'm going to skip that. But let's try to understand how this algorithm really works. So we start with the game. On the one side is the influencer, which is our homeless shelter, which is trying to choose policies, youth to bring in. On the other side, on the column player, is nature. Nature is trying to choose parameter settings to cause our algorithms to perform as worse as possible. This is a zero-sum game. Now, you can imagine if a network has 300, 400 youth, and you're trying to choose something like 30 peer leaders, that's 300 choose 30. That's massive numbers of strategies for the influencer. And nature can choose from a continuous interval. So nature also has a large number of strategies to play. So this is a massive, massive scale game that is difficult to express even, let alone solve, to represent. And so one way to solve this is by a double oracle approach. What this does is we initialize the game with some randomized initial strategies, some random initial strategies. And then we solve the game, and then influencer's oracle provides the best response, adding one new policy. And nature's oracle is going to choose its best response, adding one new set of parameters. And we now arrive at a larger game. We solve it again, and we keep iterating until we converge. And the convergence happens with a very small number of new strategies added on both sides. And despite that, we can show that this converges with some approximation guarantee. So this is the way we can solve these large scale games and arrive at the kind of solution that we want. So it's going to be robust to nature's parameters settings, adversarial parameter settings. The second is this idea of use of PomDPs for multi-step policy. I mentioned that we have to recruit something like, say, 30 youth for a 300 node network. But we can't bring them all into the homeless shelter because of capacity limits. We may only be able to bring in, say, 4 or 5 youth at a time. Supposing we select 4 youth and ask them to show up at the homeless shelter, it's possible that one of them doesn't have a bus ticket, fare for, you know, paying a bus ticket, and so may send in a substitute. Another one may get arrested on their way. So the 4 people you ask for wouldn't necessarily be the ones that show up. Maybe 3 different people show up. And so when we bring in the next 4 youth, we have to take into account who showed up in the first time step. So the next set of youth, which are shown in green, are selected without knowing the full state of the network as well, because we don't know who has got the information about HIV and who has not. This is a problem of planning under action and observation uncertainty, otherwise, which can be essentially solved with partially observable Markov decision problems, PomDPs. And the basic idea is that the planner, the PomDP policy, is going to tell us, bring in these 4 youth. When we get observation as to who actually showed up, then we ask the next set of youth to be brought in. These PomDPs are notoriously difficult to solve. And one of the ideas then is to recognize, again from immersion, that this domain has sub-communities. We have youth who hang out on the beach together, youth who may be playing basketball together. And so these sub-communities have fewer edges that cut across, which means that we can cut this problem into smaller automatically by partitioning the graph into smaller scale groups and solve the problem by solving these smaller scale graphs. So that's one way we can address this multi-step policy. Now comes the third part, which is that we can't really understand that we can't really collect data over the entire social network. That's costly. You could imagine a social worker sitting in a homeless shelter for many days, or a group of social workers trying to understand who's talking to whom and mapping out the social network, but that's very costly. If we could only sample, let's say, 20% of the network and then choose the peer leaders from this small sample, that would enormously simplify the application of this work. So what is the problem here? We have been given a total number of nodes N, which is the number of homeless youth in a shelter. We have been given a query budget. We can query up to 20 of these youth, let's say. And from this querying and understanding the friendship structure from this small set of youth, we want to output K peer leader nodes, the ones we will educate about HIV to spread influence, such that the total influence spread is similar to what we would get if you knew the entire network. So we are sampling and then using this sample to figure out the best peer leaders. So the algorithm essentially samples nodes randomly and estimates sizes of different communities and then chooses seeds from the largest K communities. And we can provide some performance guarantees on this algorithm as well. Okay, so we have network sampling, we have robustness, and we have multi-step policies to address the three challenges we mentioned. So now we can build a system, I'll call it sampling healer, to emphasize the fact that the entire social network is not known. We are sampling it. And it is going to tell us which peer leaders to bring in at every time step based on who was absent in the or present in the last time step. Now it was time to do a pilot test. We recruited 230 homeless youth, 60 under the condition of sampling healer, where the social network was not known. 60 under the condition of healer, where the social network was known, but otherwise the algorithm was the same. A healer plus is a variant of healer. And degree centrality, the more traditional approach where essentially the full network is known and we use the most popular youth to recruit. So this is the youth with the highest degree, and this is the traditional approach that is used in these shelters. In each case, we recruit 12 peer leaders according to the particular algorithm, whether it's sampling healer or degree centrality. They recommend which youth to recruit at every time step. And now the question is, which algorithm was more effective in spreading information to the non-peer leaders, the people who did not come into our information sessions? And what we find is that degree centrality reached about 25% of non-peer leaders. Healer and Healer Plus, our algorithms that knew the full network and we intelligently selected peer leaders, reached about 70%. Of the non-peer leaders. So they are far more effective in spreading HIV information. But when we came to sampling healer, which is doesn't know the network, it's just sampling the network, we still managed to reach about the same population, percentage of population of non-peer leaders as healer. There is actually a small increase, and that's likely due to just the difference in the experimental conditions. But this is very encouraging, that we can actually just sample the network and then use our algorithms, and it seems to be far more effective than the traditional approaches. So this sampling healer is the algorithm we finally used to do a large-scale study that involves 750. This is joint work with Professor Eric Rice in social work. And as far as we know, this is the first large-scale application of influence maximization for public health, and done in collaboration with three shelters, My Friend's Place, Los Angeles LGBT Center, and Safe Place for Youth. So what we did here is three arms, one which used sampling healer, one which used degree centrality, the more traditional approach, and the third one, which is no intervention at all. And so youth were selected according to the algorithm peer leaders. And then what we are interested in here is not just information spread, but actual behavior change, because that is what we finally care about. We did checks on these behavior change at the end of 1 month and at the end of 3 months. So what happened at the end of 1 month? We see that with sampling healer, there's more than 30% reduction in this HIV risk behavior of condomless anal sex. With degree centrality and control, we will see that we saw that there is very little change. So clearly sampling healer is far more effective in achieving the behavior change that we wanted quickly. At the end of 3 months, we find that sampling healer, you know, degree centrality begins to catch up, but sampling healer is still better in performance. So the fact that sampling healer was at the end of 1 month far more effective is important, because we want to get this information out there more quickly because it's a HIV risk behavior. And furthermore, this is a community where people come and go, and therefore having this information out to them faster is important. So clearly this is a very important and encouraging result. We also have other behavior changes that we measured. For example, condomless vaginal sex. Again, you can see that sampling healer is far more effective compared to degree centrality and control. All of this is appreciated by our collaborators very much.
Beautiful way to kind of like marry this tech world with this social service world, like, and how we can kind of go deeper and impact young people and elevate them.
If this group became a really big thing, it could really help out a lot of youth.
Sorry for the volume increase. I didn't anticipate that. Now, more recently, we've looked at reinforcement learning as a way of trying to solve this problem in simulation right now using sampling. And what we find is that if we use reinforcement learning compared to our hand-tuned algorithm, it seems to lead to some improvements in simulation. This is very much an active area of work. We're very interested in pushing this forward and then, of course, testing it out in the field. So whereas HIV prevention is one application, other applications we have looked at for use of social networks for public health include suicide prevention. So here the idea is that we will recruit some gatekeepers who will keep an eye out on the peers in this social network. So it could be something like if some peer in the network says, sometimes I want to sleep and never get up, the gatekeeper can then alert a counselor or inform the peer to go see a counselor. So you can imagine this is a problem of graph covering. We have to choose gatekeepers such that the entire graph is covered in terms of them being able to observe the different peers that they have. Unfortunately, not all gatekeepers will show up into the training or may not be able to perform the task allocated to them. So what this means is that we need to be able to cover the graph when some of these gatekeepers are not going to show up. So this is like a robust graph covering algorithm. So that's what we tried. So essentially, we want to robustly cover the graph knowing that some gatekeepers will not show up. So we want to maximize worst case coverage. When we tried algorithms from the literature on this front, what we find is that there's disparity of coverage across different racial groups. So basically there's fairness challenges that we need to tackle. And this is not only true for this particular application, but it is true for all the other applications. This is a topic that we are deeply committed to. And so we've been trying different approaches. Maximin fairness is one where we are trying to maximize the minimum coverage across any racial group. Diversity constraints is borrowed from cooperative game theory, the idea of core. So these are different approaches leading to different kinds of pros and cons. And the ultimate approach, it would seem, is one where we provide a number of solutions to a human in the loop who may then choose according to their particular focus areas and so forth. So this is very much a human agent active collaboration area that we are investigating at present. But we have a NeurIPS 2019 paper that looks at maximin fairness for robust graph covering if people are interested. So let me now turn to the second problem, which is health program adherence. Here I'll look at the work we've been doing with Google Research India on maternal and child care in India. A woman dies in childbirth every 15 minutes. In India, 4 out of 10 children are too thin or short. And so these are grim statistics. And Arman is a nonprofit that we're very proud to be working with, very inspiring work. They have 18 million women enrolled with 160,000 workers, the health workers that they work with. One of their programs is called M-Mitra. mobile friend. Basically, they give a weekly call to new or expectant moms. Essentially, it's a friendly 3-minute message about health in the local language, in the voice of the local health worker. It's something like, you are in the 6th week of pregnancy, you should use this health supplement. Or your child is 3 months old, you know, register in this government program. And what they've shown in randomized control trials is that there are significant benefits to the health of the baby and the mother for women who listen to all these calls. And they have up to 2.2 million women who have been enrolled in this program. But one challenge they face is that women sometimes enroll, in fact, significant fraction, and may enroll but become low listeners or drop out of the program and thus not being able to avail of the benefits of the program. So currently, once the women drop out, then Arman will go back to them and say, hey, please stay in the program, sort of a customer retention type idea, but applied to this nonprofit area. Could we predict ahead of time who's going to drop out? Because that would mean that women wouldn't lose out on the benefits. Because if women first drop out and then you try to bring them back in, it's more difficult. And also, obviously, they've lost out on listening to these health messages. So that's the task. Predict beneficiaries who are likely to drop out so that Arman could focus their intervention on those women before they drop out. So the task is something like this. Imagine woman number one, she does not pick up the phone, this automated call from Arman on week one, but listens to the call in week two, week three, week four, week five. Woman number two picks up the phone in week one and week two, but not in week three, yes in week four, not in week five. So Arman has this data on who picked up the phone every week and how much did they listen to. And so you can imagine hundreds of thousands of these records that they have. And now we know eventually woman number two, beneficiary number two and four dropped out of the program. If we could tell Arman ahead of time among the hundreds of thousands of beneficiaries that, for example, these two women or, you know, some 100 or 1,000, 5,000 women are the ones that are at high risk of drop off before they drop off, then Arman can focus on those women and try to retain them in the program by having health worker visit them in person or give them a live call and encourage them to stay in the program. So that's the task. Now, using neural networks for prediction, we did extensive tests with past data and showed that it works very well. Question is, how well will it perform for actual data in the current cycle? So we took 18,000 beneficiaries in November and December of 2019 and then made predictions and then tested it on data from January or April to April of 2020 as to whether our predictions made sense. And it turned out that our precision recall F1 scores, you can see, are all above 0.8. So all this showed is that we have a good predictive capability here as to who's going to drop off. And we've handed this software over to Arman. It's deployed. And it's helping with the 300,000 beneficiaries they have in Mitra enrolled today so that they can know who are at high risk of drop-off. We are conducting tests so that Arman is intervening on them, and we're seeing benefits in terms of retaining these women in the program so that they can avail of the benefits of the program. Now, these kinds of challenges where we want to retain people in a health program, kind of this adherence problems, Arman is not the only one that faces this problem. There's another one, for example, tuberculosis prevention, where a similar problem is faced. So tuberculosis, despite COVID, remains a major killer. India alone, there's 500,000 deaths a year and 3 million people who are infected with TB every year. One of the basic ideas, one of the basic problems, is non-adherence to TB treatment. This is a very difficult problem. People are supposed to take this medicine for 6 months. And of course, they get tired of it. They may drop off their side effects, so they may drop off of this medicine after some time. But this is problematic because it's they are not cured, but this creates drug-resistant bacteria. So we want to avoid that. Now, there's digital adherence tracking tools. So what they do is they give these patients this pill pack. And when you open this blister pack, you see the number there. So you open the phone number is randomized phone number. And patient is supposed to call that number every time they take the pill. So you open the flap, there's a phone number. You don't know what it's going to be ahead of time. You call the number to let the health workers know, I've taken my medicine for today. If they don't call for a few days, health workers know this person is dropping off of the TB treatment. And they can go to their home and say, hey, you got to take your medicine. Or call them and say, you got to take your medicine. Now, the problem, of course, that means that they didn't take their medicine for some days and then we came back. Again, the same challenge. Can we predict based on the calls that the patient gave to the health worker ahead of time as to who's going to miss doses? And so that's the task we undertook, which is from the phone call patterns, some days person called, maybe they missed a day, maybe they called at a different time than normal times. From that pattern, predict the adherence risk for a patient that this person is going to drop off. And we are able to actually do a good job. We've looked at data, 15,000 patients, 1.5 million phone calls with a nonprofit called Everwell. And we see that compared to their rule-based system, there's a boost in terms of true positives we identified, meaning those who are likely to drop off, and reduce the number of false positives. This is going through IRB approvals and so forth, so we can deploy this system in practice to identify these high-risk patients. So far I've talked to you about prediction. Now it's time for prescription, actually intervening on patients. I said we identify, let's say, 5,000 women who are at high risk of drop-off from Arman's program. We can't possibly go to each of their homes. We can't possibly call all of them to encourage them every day to stay in the program. Who do you actually intervene on? So this is the problem we face, where we're trying to call patients. So imagine there's a health worker. They have, 300 patients in their care, single health worker, and they're tasked with trying to improve adherence. These are all high risk of drop-off patients. What should she do? She can only call a few every day. So maybe she calls some K patients, so these three, and she asks them, hey, have you been adhering to your medicine, for the TB treatment? And two of them may say, yes, I am. And one last one may say, no, I didn't take my medicine. She may encourage them to take their medicine for the next day. And then she has to decide, okay, who do I call next? She may choose to return the call to the person who didn't take the medicine last night, and then choose two other patients. And again, find some patient didn't take their medicine, some did. She has to do this for 180 days because a TB treatment is 6 months long. So you can imagine every day trying to figure out who to call as a challenge. Now, the way they do it now is a round robin approach. So basically you call first 10, then you call the next 10, then you call the next 10. But this may not be the most effective approach to ensure adherence, because if you know somebody's taking their medicine, why call them again and again? They're already taking their medicine. So the approach we take is what we call adherence restless bandage. Some of you may be familiar with the idea of restless bandage. This is a special class of restless bandage called adherence bandage. So essentially you can imagine each arm or each patient is in a state of zero, that means they're not adhering, or one, that means they're adhering to taking their medicine. Now we are going to assume we know the probability with which patients transition from adhering to not adhering. In reality, of course, we don't know these probabilities. In our NeurIPS paper, we are assuming we know these probabilities. There's newer papers that are looking at ways to overcome this limitation. But let's stick with this known probabilities of transitioning. Now, when we have no observation of the arm, the patient has not given us any observation, all we have is a belief, probability of adherence. Now, here's two things that can happen. When we don't call the patient, we don't get any observation. And so our belief of what happened is just what we compute based on the transition probabilities. And generally speaking, our belief that the patient is adherence would reduce because we have no information. When we call the patient, two possibilities. The patient tells us, hey, I did take my medicine last night, in which case you have a new belief, generally speaking, higher belief that the patient is adhering. Or the patient may say, I didn't take my medicine. But since you are encouraging the patient to take their medicine, the belief is still higher than where it could have been. So you now have two outcomes when the arm is played and arm is not played. Now you could imagine this is like a massive PAMDP. You can solve, try to solve it. That turns out to be inefficient. Instead, we use the idea of Whittle index in restless bandage. Some of you may be familiar with it. If not, I'm just going to give you a little bit of an insight as to what is going on. Whittle index is important to achieve performance guarantees in restless bandage. And what we are able to show is that this restless bandage are indexable. And what we need for Whittle index is the idea of indexability. And so we are able to show that these restless bandages, these adherence restless bandages are indexable if threshold policies are optimal. And what are threshold policies? I'm going to illustrate using a forward threshold policy. So supposing you call a patient on day one and you get some observation as to whether they took their medicine or not. Then you didn't call them on day two. Then the belief that they took their medicine, that they're adhering, drops. And they didn't call it, you don't call them again. Again, it drops. And at some point, it drops below a threshold, then you call them. And the pattern repeats itself. So essentially, the idea is you call a patient and then wait until the belief drops below a threshold, then you call them again and get their belief up. This idea of threshold policies can be used in order to build fast algorithms. And we can show that compared to the best baseline, which is shown in orange here, our runtimes are significantly faster. And we lose very little in solution quality. So this is something that this adherence restless band is something we want to explore in the future. I'll turn very briefly to agent-based modeling for COVID. So we, in our PNAS 20 paper, we looked at a new agent-based model for COVID dynamics. This was because we are an agent-based modeling group, we could do things like modeling families and comorbidities and age and testing and contact tracing and all of that. And when the first results came out from the model as to what would happen in Florida and Georgia when they relaxed their lockdowns, there was some news media attention being paid to the impact. But our focus has been now to use these agent-based simulations for trying to understand policy recommendations for something like COVID testing policy. So our Science Advances paper looks at, given the range of tests that are entering the market, should we go for quantity or quality? There's the PCR test, which is the gold standard for detecting COVID-19, which is very sensitive, very low viral concentrations it can detect, but the cost is high and the turnaround time is slow. Antigen strips, though, are less sensitive, need higher viral concentrations, but they're cheap. And the turnaround time is fast. So if you're Harvard and trying to figure out, or Penn State and trying to figure out, should you be testing students using PCR or antigen strip? What should you do? And so what we find is that if both tests could be run equally frequently, despite the cost, if you're rich enough that you can run both tests equally frequently. And indeed, you can get the results equally fast in terms of turnaround time, there is no difference. Then, of course, the more sensitive test is great, the blue. However, as I mentioned, often there is a delay. So the way this is working is that we're testing students, and if any student is found to be positive, we are going to isolate them. But if there is a delay, like a day's delay in getting results back, suddenly the more sensitive test stops being effective. It leads to higher numbers of infections. So in this case, this more sensitive test, even though we are paying more, doesn't work. And if we are paying more and we cannot run it as frequently, again, what we find is if you can only run it, let's say every 5 days instead of the less sensitive test, which can only run every 3 days, again, the more sensitive test leads to higher infections. So what do we conclude from this? That test sensitivity is secondary to turnaround time and frequency for COVID-19 surveillance. That is to say, go with the fast turnaround, less sensitive test. In fact, this has been referred to, this work was referenced in the WHO guidance reference, the World Health Organization, and covered extensively in the news media like New York Times and so forth, and has allowed our AP collaborators, Professor Michael Mina, for example, to advocate this fast testing approach to the FDA and CDC. So I know I have just around 10 to 12 minutes left. And so I'm going to turn to a second topic that I wanted to cover today, which is conservation. So here we are interested in trying to protect large conservation areas. In Uganda, this Queen Elizabeth National Park, thousands of square kilometers, wonderful wildlife, but there's threats to the wildlife in terms of these snares or traps, thousands of them that get set every year to maim and kill these animals. And you can imagine a ranger's task of going around this forest, trying to look for a trap or a snare hidden somewhere. It's a very difficult task to search when you have a small number of rangers covering thousands of square kilometers. So what we do here is try to help these rangers by, imagine that you take the Queen Elizabeth Park and divide it up into 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer grid square. And now we are trying to cast this problem as a Stackelberg security game. For those who are not familiar with this idea, this model, essentially each square kilometer is a target. If there's water in some area, more animals, it's a higher value target. And now we can cast this problem as a game. So basically on the row side is the ranger, the defender, and they're trying to choose patrolling strategies to find snares. And generally speaking, they'll choose some kind of randomized strategy. So they'll sometimes be in area one, sometimes in area two. And the poacher is trying to look at where the rangers are, where they're patrolling, and then choose a spot to place the snare to be maximally effective for themselves. Now, normally, Stackelberg security games have been solved with the idea of a rational adversary. Here we face boundedly rational poachers in that we have past data on the basis of which we can predict where the poachers tend to set traps or snares in response to the kind of patrolling the rangers have done in the past. So we have 14 years of data from Uganda, for example, when we started this work. And it's things like, for each grid square, what was the range of patrol frequency? How many snares were found? We have distance to rivers, roads, and villages for that particular piece of land, or area slope. So based on all of these features, we should be able to predict where poachers set traps or snares, of the probability with which we can find a snare in that particular grid square. Now, this prediction problem, after we predict, then of course we will prescribe a patrol, but first we have to predict. This prediction problem is faced with uncertainty in observations, because sometimes the rangers will report that they didn't find a snare in a grid square, but there was a snare there. They just, you know, it was well hidden. They couldn't find it. They didn't search enough. Now, to overcome these problems, there's an ensemble model we have come up with. Given that we're running out of, we will be running out of time, I'm going to just sort of quickly skip over it, say that there is this ensemble model we created to make these predictions. And the first test of this ensemble model in the real world was in 2016, where they asked us, tell us where to find snares in areas we haven't patrolled before. So we chose these 2 9-square-kilometer areas which were infrequently patrolled. So you can see them, the two areas at the bottom here. You can see that there are green dots. That's where we are asking the rangers to patrol. And you see that they don't overlap with the red dots. The red dots were where previously snares have been found. So we're not asking rangers to just go back to where they found snares. We're asking them to go to newer areas and saying, you know, you're going to find snares here. Now, this happened just a month before a conference deadline, which means that we made these recommendations, asked the rangers to go patrol. If they find snares, we are going to write a paper. If they don't find snares, there's not going to be a paper. And so the rangers would go out, and every day we get an email, what happened today? So first, nothing happened. Then a poached elephant was found, so with its tusks cut off. So we were too late for this elephant, but at least we were being pointed in the right direction. The very next day, great news, the rangers found an elephant snare roll and removed it. So poachers were active in the area. They were killing elephants, but before they could kill the next set of elephants, we were able to remove this snare role, potentially saving these lives of elephants. And then antelope snares were removed. So this was a very encouraging initial pilot test that seemed to indicate that we are on the right track to help the rangers go to newer areas and remove snares. So then it was time to do an extensive test. So we did this in three national parks, Queen Elizabeth, Murchison Falls, and Sripok Wildlife Sanctuary, the first two in Uganda, the last one in Cambodia. In each case, we selected 24 areas. These are infrequently patrolled areas. Some we designated as high risk. So our model predicted you're going to find more snares here. And some we designated as low risk. Our model predicted you're going to find less snares here. And we set rangers to search these areas for 6 months. And at the end of 6 months, what we find is where we predicted high risk, indeed more snares were found. Where we predicted low risk, lower number of snares were found. So these predictions are really working to discriminate different areas, even areas where there wasn't past data available in as much quantity. And this also held true across different parks, across different risk areas. So this is a highly encouraging result. So I'll come to what implications this has for global strategy for fighting poaching. In fact, these are some pictures from Cambodia where the numbers of snare captures have jumped fivefold from 2018 to 2019. Now, okay, so we had great predictions. Now it's time to prescribe patrolling strategies. So to understand what kind of patrols happen, we've actually patrolled with different ranger groups. So for example, this is us in Malaysia working with Panthera, which is an NGO. You can see us starting the day on the left, laughing, you know, we're very happy, we're going on a patrol, hacking through the forest, and then at the end of the day, totally exhausted, realizing this is a very difficult task. So there are lots of constraints that you have to take care of. But there is insufficient data, which means that there can be errors in planning patrols on targets. The most important thing we have to recognize is that when we have data and we're trying to just maximize learning accuracy, that doesn't mean we get the best patrols out of it. Learning accuracy, improving learning accuracy doesn't result in maximizing decision quality. So I'm going to give you a hint about what we mean by game-focused learning, and I'm going to have to move a little quickly given that we have just about 5 minutes left. So normally what we would do is maximize prediction accuracy. Where do adversaries set traps or snares? And we find, as you know, the higher the blue here, the more the accuracy here. And so the loss function is the traditional loss function. And having done that, then we say, okay, now let's plan patrol coverage. But in this case, what's happening is that the middle two targets, the only ones really that impact our expected utility, trying to get accurate these other two targets that contribute very little to the expected utility of the defender is not useful. So what this means is that our machine learning model should be an end-to-end model that, as its loss function, uses the defender expected utility. And what this means is it'll lead to better result in the end, higher decision quality. It'll lead to worse accuracy in learning, but it'll lead to higher decision quality in the end. If we want to understand it in terms of gradient descent, normal gradient descent will only look at the first two stages of our data to deployment pipeline, trying to pass gradients back from just the prediction stage to get our accuracy as high as possible. We are saying with game-focused learning, pass gradients back from the decision that was taken, from the result of the decision here, simulation, and pass gradients back all the way. So that way the model is being adjusted as to the result of the decision quality rather than just the learning accuracy, because we want higher decision quality, not just higher learning accuracy. And so this, we can show, leads to better results in simulation. Testing them in practice is something for future work. In the last few minutes, I wanted to tell you about recent work that's looked at working with an NGO called Air Shepherd. They fly drones in South Africa. At night, they'll try to take these images. You can see here, the images are sent to a van, beamed to a van, where there's a human being looking at these infrared images, trying to see, is there a poacher that we can see? You can see some blacks and some, you know, maybe white looking shapes, but are these poachers, not poachers? Very difficult for a human being staying awake at midnight, trying to figure out what's going on. Instead, we've developed this system called Spot that automatically detects poachers and animals and given it to Air Shepherd to use. I want to highlight one particular use of Spot. So the idea here is that Air Shepherd will fly their drone, they'll see a set of poachers, then they'll call rangers, and the rangers will come and arrest the poachers or what have you. However, the probability that the rangers may arrive may be very low because we don't have that many rangers. So what do? Air Shepherd uses deceptive signaling. So they'll turn on the light, it's late at night, and fly towards the poacher, indicating that rangers are on their way. And they can show here, as in this video here, that poachers run away when they do that. But if you are always going to turn on the light when there are no rangers and fly towards the poachers, poachers know that you're deceiving them, and they'll essentially ignore you. So we must be strategic in deceptive signaling. And this idea of Stackelberg security games with optimal deceptive signaling was in part of the thesis of Haifeng Shuai, who I know is the next speaker after me in this seminar series. So he'll be able to tell you even more. I'll just give you a highlight of what his thesis entails. Just a very simple example of one of the algorithms from his thesis. So basically you have the poachers, and supposing they enter, they know the probability that a ranger is present is 0.3, ranger is not present is 0.7. So now you have a drone flying overhead who not only knows the probabilities, but knows whether the ranger is actually present. And when the ranger is actually present, it is going to honestly signal to the poachers, ranger is present, you better run away. When the ranger is not present, it is going to use smaller, this 0.3 probability to signal to the rangers, to the poachers that a ranger is present. Now these probabilities are adjusted such that the poachers know they are being deceived. They know that 50% of the time they're getting this deceptive signal, but it is still in their best interest to run away. And so when there's, so basically what we are doing is, in some cases, when the ranger is present, we are honestly signaling to the poachers that a ranger is present. And in other cases, when the ranger is not present, we are honestly signaling the ranger is not present. But there's some cases where the ranger is not present, where we are deceptively signaling the ranger is present. So by cleverly choosing these probabilities, we make it in the best interest of our adversary to believe our deception, even though they know that they are being deceived. And there's some interesting results as to the complexity of these algorithms when you include these kinds of deceptive strategies and so on. But since I'm out of time, I'm going to skip over and just say that the PAWS system that we've built, given all the advances we've made, is now available across the globe for all of, different NGOs and rangers to download, to predict where poachers are setting traps. This is in collaboration with SMART, which is a partnership of these different NGOs. And we are very excited that this is now available. Extensive testing is going on. We're very excited to see what's going to happen next. So I'll end here by drawing some key lessons from our work in AI for social impact or AI for social good. First, in our view, achieving social impact and innovating in AI goes hand in hand. They're not opposites. You don't have to choose between, hey, I want to achieve social impact, so I have to give up on AI research. Second, we have to take a data to deployment perspective. We shouldn't be focused in this area of AI for social impact on just achieving that improvement in algorithms, because that's what's important for AI conferences. Rather, take the whole view of going from data to deployment. And this also means that AI conferences have to use new evaluation criteria for work on AI for social impact. It is important for us to step out of the lab and into the field. Obviously, in pandemic times, this is difficult, but this is what we really should be trying to do, to go out in the field, understand the problems, to embrace interdisciplinary work with social work researchers, with conservation scientists. In all of these domains, you'll see us fighting the data. There's no social network available, yet we are trying to do influence maximization. The data on wildlife conservation, it's very limited. You're trying to fight bias in that data and so on. So lack of data is a norm, and it has to be part of the project strategy to deal with it. And finally, we really are interested in empowering nonprofits to use AI tools themselves. We ultimately want to avoid being the gatekeepers to this AI for social impact technology. So that's it. I'll end here. There's a number of collaborators that I've listed here who have been instrumental in allowing this work to succeed. Thank you for listening. Thank you for inviting me. And I'm very happy to take questions now and continue to interact in the future. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Milind. Thank you for that. Thank you, first of all, for making time during this difficult time to come and talk here. And thank you for the very inspiring work, especially the new work that I did not know was happening. At this point, if people have questions, I know Aman Gangwani has already sent one question in. So Aman, if you want to unmute yourself and ask that question, and if other people have questions, they can either send me a chat or they can directly unmute themselves and ask a question to Milind. Aman?
Yeah, so I had a question on Arman. So can Arman also aggregate data on socioeconomic status to better predict whether someone would drop out of the program, assuming there's a correlation between socioeconomic status and the dropout rate? And then that way you could predict drop off before they enter the program and assign extra resources to prevent that.
That's an excellent point. And in fact, our prediction model uses all of this data that are available about each beneficiary. So we have data about their education status, their first pregnancy or second or so forth, as well as their socioeconomic strata status data, whatever is available to us, and uses that to make predictions on whether they drop off. So we are using whatever data is available to us trying to make these predictions.
Okay, yeah, I wasn't sure if you were just using the phone calls, which would have been an interesting take, or if you were aggregating everything.
Yes, we are. So the phone calls is the more interesting part, because there you are trying to do some the sequencing data that needs to be somehow accumulated and aggregated in order to make predictions. But you're right, we also use additionally the social, in any other data that we have about these beneficiaries.
And actually, just as a quick follow-up, is there a reason that for the Arman and TB program that you chose to use phone calls instead of like a texting functionality in order to check up on patients?
That's an excellent question also. Yes, it turns out that the texting they have shown in research is just not as effective. And so it's sort of this underlying research that has led both these nonprofits, Everwell as well as Arman, to focus on phone calls rather than texts.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Anand. Are there other questions?
Yeah, I can ask you a question. Oh, yeah. So thank you very much for this great talk. And also thank you for popularizing and applying all these techniques from game theory and multi-agent systems. It's really great to see them in practice solving real world problems, which actually takes me to my first question, which is, one of the most difficulties is kind of defining a baseline here to measure efficacy of your solutions. And I'm just curious, like, what do you do in order to make sure that your baselines are at least subtle or accurate baseline there?
So in each case, it's a case by case basis. And traditionally our approach has been to see what was the current practice and then compare it to that current practice. So for example, when it is HIV prevention work, the current practice is bring in the most popular youth, which is the degree centrality, the traditional approach. And therefore that's what we are comparing with. With something like Arman and so forth, the current practice is, okay, wait for people to drop off and then call them. And the question is, what fraction of people do they identify in that fashion versus the kind of prediction we are able to make. Now, their approach obviously means you have to wait until people drop off and then call them, but we are able to identify a different group of people. So in each case, it's a different particular way. And you're right that when we have something like wildlife conservation, and they just didn't have the predictive technology, And we are making predictions to ask them to go in areas they didn't patrol before. What, you know, what is the right baseline to use? Because they didn't have this tool or anything like this beforehand. So one of the things we have looked at is trying to understand what can be the concerns. So for example, one concern is that if you're in Uganda in a wildlife park, let's say conservation area, and you know, you go to some area where there is no patrolling that has happened for many months or years, you're going, the objection can be, you're going to find snares in any such area because, you know, you haven't been there for many years. So every such area should have snares. So that is why we did the second test where we said, okay, we are going to make predictions in areas where there was less patrols in the past. But we are going to say some of these are high risk, where you're going to find snares, and some of these are low risk, where you're not going to find snares. And we are able to discriminate between the two. So it's in this way, we are essentially saying that it's not like we're blindly predicting, you know, anywhere there's less patrols in the past, you're going to find snares. But there's something more to it, some more intelligence to it in making these predictions. So it's a very interesting challenge. I mean, especially in the field, particularly to convince our partners, because it's no longer a simulation exercise to convince just the referees, who are obviously very important components of evaluating the work in the AI. So it's not the AI, just the AI referees, but the domain experts who need to be convinced that the work has merit. And so you have to use the baselines that they would find convincing. And it becomes therefore quite an interesting challenge. So thank you for that question.
Well, thank you for that response. I have a second question, which is a little bit more specific and technical. Maybe it's about your work on influence maximization.
Yeah.
And I think you've done a similar work like in these type of interventions in different type of problems, from HIV to the medical or drug usage. So have you thought about like the presence of disinformation? So essentially I'm thinking about your social network graph as a directed graph that can have some sort of a backward negative disinformation kind of component to it.
We have not done it. We have thought about it. So you are right. So in particular, as we get closer to a COVID-19 vaccine, for example, there's going to be disinformation about the vaccine. There's going to be messages about not taking the vaccine. And, you know, so these are things that are important in the public health arena to combat. And in the past, we've done some such work where you can imagine there's one group that is trying to send a positive message and one group trying to send a negative message. And we are trying to make sure that the positive message from our perspective, gets more play or neutralizes the negative message in the social network. But that was in simulation. So it's a game, it's a wonderful game theoretic problem of trying to figure out, you know, what kind of counter influencers, if you will, to choose in order to neutralize a negative message. However, we have not done this for real in the public health context, and we would be delighted to think of, you know, particular problems to focus on, and you know what kind of data are available and things like that. But it's definitely a very interesting area. I would love to talk to you more about it, try to see, you know, how we can collaborate, etc.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you, Milind.
Right. If there's one final question that somebody else would like to ask, otherwise we're out of time. So, I mean, I can ask one question about the COVID work that you did.
Uh-huh.
So, I mean, we have, I mean, at Penn State, I mean, I have also invested a little into COVID testing in the sense, right? And basically, we were not looking at different kinds of COVID tests. We were looking at just... you have a single kind of a test, whom do you distribute them to? Do you distribute them to symptomatic people or do you distribute them to asymptomatic people? And what is the trade-off? What do you get? What benefits, gains do you get on these tests in terms of minimizing COVID infections if you use a particular trade-off as opposed to a different trade-off? Now, in the slides that you had, you were looking at different kinds of tests, right? One was a paper-based test and one was a PCR test. Is there a possibility for thinking about going about, you know, having a portfolio of this. So if you have, let's say, $50,000 and you have to buy procure tests for your population, let's say Penn State or Harvard, how do you distribute this money into buying the highly sensitive, the tests that take a long time to come back versus the cheaper tests that are not as sensitive? How do you come up with a portfolio of all these tests? And is there a place, is there a requirement, or do we envision there being a benefit to adaptivity of this portfolio? So you know, we can adapt this portfolio over time. So is that something that you have thought about, or
It's a great question, Amulya. And as far as I know, this is exactly the conversation that is happening in universities today as to what to do. And so several universities, as far as I know, I mean, I saw conversations between epidemiologists who are struggling as to what is the right thing to do at different universities across the US. And so this is something very interesting to think through and suggest, you know, and if you can come up with a rapid solution to this problem and make suggestions, I think that would be highly beneficial for universities. I understand that some smaller colleges are really, I mean, this is a real challenge in particular, where the costs, particularly for the more sensitive tests, can be really a huge problem for the budgets and so on. And so trying to come up with cost-effective measures and so forth would be really very interesting. So, yeah, if you're interested, I would say go for it. And, quick responses to this would be awesome for people.
Right. Well, thank you for that wonderful seminar, Milind. Thank you all for attending.